Somehow, despite the fact that for most of the month, my brain felt like it had been removed and then replaced with lint, I managed to actually get a lot of reading done this month, and I'm really not sure how, but that 24-hour readathon I did where I read for 24 hours out of a weekend probably helped a bit. Hi everyone, Rosie here. Welcome or welcome back to my channel, and happy March! February is over, March is here. I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing. I read some great books in February. I have some great books that I'm looking forward to reading in March. But before we can get to talking about the great books of March, let's do my February wrap-up. I'm going to structure it a bit differently this time. Usually I just go chronologically in order of finish time, but this month, I have some books that I think have more impact when discussed together, or at least for me in my reading experience. Reading them together made me appreciate each one more, so I want to discuss those as a group. So I'm going to talk about those first, and then talk about the other books that I read. I picked this group of books to read together, not knowing how much they were going to complement each other. I picked out a collection of books for my TBR to read in February because it was Black History Month, and I wanted to read some books by Black authors about Black history. I'm fully in support of reading diversely throughout the year. I don't like this idea that we should only read these types of books in February and then ignore them for the rest of the year. But I also have a really long TBR of books I want to read, and sometimes things can fall through the cracks. I'm interested in them, I want to read them, I know that they're going to be important and impactful, but with so many books to choose from, it's easy to pass things over. So I use themes or things going on in a month to sort of help me narrow it down. It helps me actually pick up these books that I want to read and discover new works that I'm excited about instead of falling victim to analysis paralysis, reading shitty Poirot novels. Not that I think Agatha Christie is shitty, I'm just not liking Poirot novels, but still reading them. Anyways, it's a whole thing. And, you know, rereading Discworld books. Those are both great things to read, but I also want to make sure I'm prioritizing these other books. So sometimes I just need a little bit of an excuse to actually do it, whether that's a readathon or something particular that's going on in a certain month. Sometimes it's nice to have that push. I picked the next four books because they were related to the overall theme of Black history, and especially Black history in the US, because those were the books that I already owned. I do want to do some more reading and read about other countries' experiences, including Canada's, but for now, these were the ones that I already had bought and I wanted to read, so I picked them up, but I didn't expect them to have much overlap. Black history is a huge theme. I wasn't going in thinking that they were going to be really interrelated, but then as I read, they kind of were, and it was a really interesting experience. So I'm going to talk about each book individually, and then I have a bit of an overall discussion today, which is something I don't normally do on my wrap-ups, but we're going to try it out. The first of these that I read was Singin' and Swingin' and Gettin' Merry Like Christmas by Maya Angelou. This is the third in her series of autobiographies, and takes place in the early 1950s when she is working in show business in many different forms. I read this during the 24 and 48 readathon that I did in February. The vlog will be linked up here. So I don't have that many notes on it. Honestly, I read it in a single day because I sat down, I picked it up and started reading it, and it was so amazing that I just got totally swept up in her story and didn't stop to take any notes really. But it is heartbreaking, it is beautiful, it is incredibly insightful, and is an incredible autobiography. I don't know at all what goes on in the next four, because I think there's seven total in this series, but I'm so excited to read them because her writing is just phenomenal. I'm so in love with it, and this was such an interesting addition to the series. It felt no less wonderful than the first two, but because she is now an adult and this focuses more on her work life and her experiences in different respects in that way, it was a very different read. Again, still amazing, but very different. Next, I read Homegoing by Yaa Gyasi. This is about a number of generations in a family. I think I said before it was 10. I don't think it's actually 10 generations. I think it might be 8 generations. Anyways, it's a multi-generational story about a family that is descended from two half-sisters who lived in Ghana in the 1700s and where their descendants end up. one of the sisters remains in Ghana, and her children and grandchildren, so on, are living through the slave trade and the colonial experience from that point of view. And one of the sisters is sold into slavery and finishes her life in the US. And then, of course, her descendants follow that storyline and that side of the experience. This book is phenomenal. I have a whole vlog where I talk about how amazing this book is and how much I love it, so I won't go into more detail in that here because I feel like you guys are so sick of hearing me tell you about how much I love this book. But seriously, go check it out. Check out my vlog, get the book, read it. It's amazing. The next book I read was Notes of a Native Son by James Baldwin. This is a collection of essays that he wrote in the 1950s, and I'm gonna read about what it's about because I couldn't sum it up myself. It is about life in Harlem, the protest novel, movies, and African Americans abroad. I really enjoyed reading these, but I don't feel like I gave them enough attention to be able to speak to them or give like a proper review of them. As I said, my brain was completely replaced with lint in the second half of February, so although I stuck to my reading plan and read this book instead of just comfort reading Discworld novels, I don't think I had the capacity to give it the proper thought that these essays deserve. These are beautiful, complex, insightful essays, and I just wasn't thinking about them deeply. I feel like this is a sort of book where you could read an essay and then spend an hour just thinking about it or just discussing it and then read the next one, and I was not reading them that way. However, even without that sort of proper attention, the writing in this was incredible. It was so impactful. I don't think I have highlighted that many quotes in a book ever, because just it felt like every page there was a new sentence that just hit you so hard. And finally, throughout most of the month, I was listening to the audiobook of The Warmth of Other Suns by Isabel Wilkerson. This is a history of the Great Migration, which is the term used to refer to the migration of something like, I think, 6 million Black Southerners from the south of the US to the north and west between 1915 and 1970. So there's this huge tidal wave, basically, of people leaving the south and trying to make a better life for themselves in the north and the west of the country. This is a massive book, which is both a history of the migration overall and about the social pressures and the situations that were causing people to move, what the sort of general trends were, what the various waves were, what life was like for migrants once they arrived in these other parts of the country. But it's also a detailed biography of three people who migrated themselves. We follow a woman who moved from Mississippi to Chicago in the 1930s, a man who moved from Florida to Harlem in the 1940s, and then another man who moved from Louisiana to Los Angeles in the 1950s. And we don't just follow their migration story, we follow their entire life story from their birth and their childhood through their early adulthood, through why each of them decided to migrate, and then we continue to hear about their stories once they arrived at their destinations and what life was like for them. Did they achieve what they were hoping? Was it everything they wished for? Was it better? Was it worse? How did their lives turn out? Wilkerson spent hundreds of hours interviewing each of these individuals in the mid-90s and actually hearing their stories firsthand, which I think lends an incredible touch to this book. And not only that, she also spent loads of time interviewing their acquaintances and their friends and their families and did sort of shorter versions of the interview with thousands of migrants before she decided which three she actually wanted to write about in detail. So she's got this huge wealth of firsthand recount that she's using to base this book on, in addition to things like census records and all of that sort of stuff. You can really tell just how much work went into this book, and I don't mean that in a negative way. I mean that in a, you feel the amount of care and effort and dedication that Wilkerson had to properly telling these stories and communicating this information and doing it in the absolute best way possible. If you are looking for a nonfiction book that is going to make you feel so many things, then I can't recommend this book highly enough. There were points where I wanted to cry because of the incredible cruelty that these individuals and Black people in general were suffering under. I was filled with rage at the oppression that they were facing. And also, I felt the shadow or the echo of the terror that these people must have felt living in the South during the Jim Crow era, because the way Wilkerson writes a lot of the book and a lot of these people's stories, you have that feeling like this could erupt into violence at any moment. And you really feel sort of that fear that must have been so present in life all of the time of you never feel like you're really safe. That tension. But at the same time, this is not a sensationalist book. This doesn't over-exaggerate the situation or anything like that. It's very much based in these people's real stories and in the real data of what was happening, which almost makes it that much more tense, because you know that this isn't the dramatized version that's 10 times more intense and crazy than reality was. This was reality. This is reality, and that's really impactful. I obviously don't have a physical copy to show you here, but if you have been put off this book in the past because it is massive, it's a very chunky book. I think the physical copy is something like 600 pages long. The audiobook version that I listened to was over 20 hours. Don't be intimidated. It is big, it is long, but this is not one of those long books where you could edit out 200 pages and end up with a better book. This book is totally justified in its length. I don't feel like there was a single sentence in this that was extra or unnecessary, because every single one is incredible and impactful and just really, really wonderfully done. My last thing that I'll say about this book, which I probably talked about it for like 5 minutes already, but in the audiobook, the narrator does do accents for the various people and sort of reflects what their accents were. Usually that really bothers me in audiobooks. In this case, it was, again, incredibly done. I think that's partly because the author is Black, the narrator is Black, and it is all done with total respect. It never feels like an accent is being used to make me laugh or because I'm supposed to find it funny or silly or have a certain judgment about the person because of their accent. It very much feels more like they are trying to reproduce what these people said and what their stories were in their own words and in their own way of speaking. As I said, I wanted to talk about why I'm glad I read these books in such a short time span. I read a lot of the ebooks sort of back to back, and then the audiobook I was listening to while I read all of these. And for the first time in a long time, and possibly for the first time since I was doing assigned reading for school, I really actively felt the whole way through like the combination of the books was augmenting each reading experience. I didn't realize it at all when I was picking these books out, but they really have complementary themes and topics, and they all sort of, at least in part, connect back to the Great Migration. The connection is, of course, obvious for The Warmth of Other Suns, but for example, Angelou, although she never explicitly references it, in reading her autobiography, I realized that, oh, right, her parents were part of the Great Migration, and then they send for her once they're a bit more established on the West Coast. Her story is part of the story of the Great Migration. She's one of the many people who knows what her life would have turned out to be had her parents not made that transition. And Baldwin was another product of the Great Migration because his father had been one of the very early migrants, I think just after World War I, and Baldwin actually discusses at various points in his essays what it's like to grow up as the child of one of these migrants and what impact that has had on the city where he lives and the city where he grew up and the people who surrounded him. And then finally, Homegoing, which is completely fictional, also features a migration. In one of the chapters, one of the descendants of the sister who was sold into slavery makes the migration in, I think, the 1930s from the South to Harlem. I'm not exaggerating at all when I say that there is a rough sequence of events that shows up in three out of these four books, and it's eerily similar. We see it in one of the biographies in The Warmth of Other Suns. We see Baldwin's sort of social commentary on the phenomenon as it was unrolling, and we see the fictionalized version of it in Homegoing. These books are all incredible. Every single one of these is well worth reading on its own. However, this really made me appreciate each of them more for having read it in such close proximity to the others. I think because I read all four and I was reading about these sorts of topics and thinking about these things for so much more of the month and reading something in one book and connecting it to another, it really, really augmented my reading experience. All right, it's just taking me 30 minutes to talk about those four books, so let's hope I can move a bit faster for the rest of the books I read this month. And the next three are going to be really fast, because I read three romance novels in February. I read The Duchess Deal by Tessa Dare, A Duke, The Lady, and a Baby by Vanessa Riley, and The Devil in Winter by Lisa Kleypas. And I actually made an entire video about my experience reading those books and reviewing them, which I'm going to link up here. Highly recommend you check that one out if you're interested in hearing my thoughts, but since I already talked about it for something like 25 minutes, I'm not gonna go into more detail now. And now we come to the other books I read. These ones don't have any sort of grouping at all, they're just books I happened to read in February, so let's just go through them. First of all, I read Nimona by Noelle Stevenson. This is a graphic novel about a young shapeshifter who wants to apprentice herself to a supervillain. He's not sure he needs an apprentice, but basically takes her in because she seems kind of useful and also sort of doesn't have anywhere else to go, and shenanigans ensue. I read this during my 24 in 48 vlog again. That one's gonna be linked down below because I feel like I'm gonna reference it a bunch in this video, and I don't have too much to say about it. It was a reread for me. I really enjoyed it. It was really fun, but I read it on something like hour 20 of my readathon, so I wasn't really having many critical thoughts, and also I read it in one sitting, and again, I never take many notes if I read things in one sitting. It was fun, it was great, but I don't have much to say about it. Next up, I read Witches Abroad by Terry Pratchett. This is another one that I picked up towards the end of my 24 and 48 readathon because I needed something light and comforting and familiar. This one is one of the witches books, as the name would suggest, and in this one, we really get into stories and narrative and what does it all mean and how does it play out in our lives. If you like books that have fairy tale or book references in them, this is definitely the Pratchett to check out. There were so many that I didn't remember from previous readings and just made me laugh so much. I promise that one of these days I will actually take proper notes and write a proper review of a Pratchett novel, but that is not this day. This is all I've got to say for now. Next up we have Le Parfum by Patrick Suskind. This is a reread for me and is the first French book I read of the year, so I'm actually on track to read six in the year because that's one every 2 months. Second month of the year, I've read one French book. Doing okay so far. This is about a strange man named Grenouille who lives in France in the 1700s. He emits no odor but has a super smeller nose, and the like subtitle of this book is The Story of a Murderer, so it goes some weird places. I really enjoyed reading this book despite the fact that it was a lot grosser than I remembered. It was still enjoyable and I found the language really accessible. It's very literary in style, but at the same time I didn't feel like it was hard to read at all, which was very nice. However, I have very few thoughts on this. I almost wonder if it's because last time I read it for school, so I took really careful notes, and I think I wrote an essay on it or something. So maybe this time my brain was just like totally switched off, not observing anything. I don't know, I don't have much commentary to give. I also read The Devil and the Dark Water by Stuart Turton this month. This is a possibly fantasy, definitely mystery novel set on a boat that is sailing from Indonesia to Amsterdam in the 1600s. And I don't want to say much more than that at all about the plot or what it's about, because I think this is a book that benefits from going in blind and not really knowing what to expect and going through and going, what's going on? So I don't want to give anything away, but I do have a lot of thoughts about the book in general, so I'm going to talk about those instead. I absolutely loved Turton's debut novel, The Seven and a Half Deaths of Evelyn Hardcastle, so I was a bit worried when starting this that it wasn't going to be able to live up to it and I wasn't going to enjoy it as much. Also, it's like 400 pages long, which doesn't sound like that long as a number, but then you see the book physically, it's huge. So I was a bit intimidated as well, but I read it as a buddy read with Katie from Katie Reads and Rants. We'd set ourselves a goal of like, okay, we're gonna get to halfway by 2 weeks into the month and then we'll finish it at the end of the month. And it was so gripping that we ended up finishing it in the first 2 weeks of the month because we just couldn't stop reading it. It was so good. I'm pretty sure I read something like the last 150 pages in one sitting one evening because I just had to know what was happening. I had to know how it all resolved. I honestly don't know how this book was so gripping though, because the mystery itself is very slow burn. Progress is very slow. Every answer that they find seems to reveal three more questions, you're left totally confused for the vast majority of the book, and yet it's action-packed. I think part of what made it so fun is that Turton takes a lot of tropes that we're familiar with from the mystery genre, and then sort of flips them or plays with them and does something different that you don't expect with them. Things like having a famous detective, having a very enclosed setting and no one can come or go. There's certain interpersonal relationships that you think are gonna go one way based on everything you've read, and then they do something totally different, and you're just left going, what? Basically, if you think you see how something fits together in this book, it's probably about to flip completely. Also, the writing is just really captivating. There is a storm sequence in this book, which I think has to last close to 50 pages. There's many chapters of the book just about this one storm that this boat is sailing through. And it managed to make my adult brain feel the way I felt when I was 13 and watching Pirates of the Caribbean. Like, that amazing rush of excitement and thrill and like, oh my god, this is so cool, that a 13-year-old brain is capable of, my adult brain produced for 50 straight pages. Tell me where you can get that kind of serotonin rush in today's world. However, I do understand why Turton's writing is a bit love it or hate it. I can totally understand how all of these things that have made me read this book and go, oh my goodness, I'm so excited and I love it so much, could be total turnoffs for another reader. Especially when it is billed as a murder mystery, which it isn't exactly at all. If you go in expecting a classic murder mystery type story, I can see why you would go, this is so weird and I don't like it. However, I think it's incredible. I thought it was really great and well worth reading. And the last book that I read in February was Narcoland by Anabel Hernandez. This is all about the Mexican drug cartels and how they are very interlinked with the Mexican government and police and things like that. I hadn't planned to read this book, but I've been wanting to read it since I think last July when I hauled it, and I keep seeing it and keep going, I'm really excited about that. That sounds really great. I must read it. And then I was editing my friend's tag one night, and so I reviewed my footage of me like talking about it and getting excited about it. And so it was on my mind, and I wanted something to read alongside Homegoing because Homegoing was amazing, but I also didn't want to binge read it. I wanted to give myself time to process. So I needed another book to pick up. Initially I was thinking, oh, I'll read something light. I'll read something fun. And then somehow my brain got fixated on this, because I guess nothing says light and fun like a 400-page book about corruption. Anyways, this is a book that I bought because the topic and the content sounded really fascinating, but I had never really seen any reviews, positive or negative, about this book before I bought or before I read it. So I didn't really know what to expect going in. I had really high hopes because it sounded really interesting, and unfortunately it just didn't really live up to my expectations, honestly. The content is just as interesting and also horrifying as I expected, but for me the execution just fell a bit flat. I found it really hard to follow, honestly. Both within chapters and between chapters, I felt like there was a lot of just going, wait, what's going on? Why are we here? Who is this person? Why did we just jump in time? What's going on and how is all of this related? Also, this book covers a lot of content. Arguably too much content. We follow a span of something like 50 years, I think, and there are so many people, which is understandable. This is a huge topic. There is a lot going on here. And as an overview of the situation, I guess that makes sense to do it this way, where you're not focusing in on any one person that much. But I think for me as a reader, I would have enjoyed it more and also gotten a lot more out of it if it had been a bit more focused in on one part of the time period or one of the individuals or something like that, and done more in-depth analysis as opposed to this put everything in here approach. This is also not helped by the names. As I said, there are about 5 million people in this book. There are so many of them, and because it's about corruption and cartels and backstabbing and everyone is playing three sides, it's confusing having that many people to begin with. But then the naming convention doesn't help at all. As is common in Mexican naming, everyone has basically at least three, if not four or five names, and they can be referred to by many combinations of those names. So there is one person in this book who is called Jorge Teo Peon, which I'm probably pronouncing that terribly, and I apologize to my Spanish profs. He can be referred to as Jorge Teo, or Teo Peon, and probably more that I didn't catch. I was something like halfway through the book when I realized concretely that those three names were referring to the same person. It really felt like not only are there tons of people in this book, but it's really hard to keep track of who's who when you're using a different name for them. There was a note on names at the back, but there was just too many for even that to help me keep them straight, and I was constantly confused about who was being talked about, where they fell on everything, what was going on with them. And finally, I found the pace just a bit frenetic for my tastes. This is a long book. I think it's something like 400 pages, and it is action-packed. There is so much that is happening in this book, and there are so many things going on that I just felt tense while reading it and like on edge, and I just didn't find it very enjoyable. So this one didn't work out for me. I didn't hate it, clearly. I didn't DNF it. I'm glad to have read it and seen the content that was in it. It just didn't quite work for me as a overall experience. But then again, I don't think I'm the primary audience for this book. It's about an issue in Mexican society by a Mexican author. I think it was first written in Spanish and then later translated into English. I don't want to hate on it too much, I say, having just told you all of the things I didn't like about this book. Maybe it's my reading of it, though, not the book itself. So those are the 12 books that I read in February. I really liked a lot of them. I've had a really good reading month overall, but I am ready for a bit of a change of pace. It was a lot of reading, so good thing I set myself a very ambitious TBR for March. That was good planning. Go me. Hopefully it'll lead to more pushing myself and more great reading, though. Let me know down below, have you read any of these? If you have, what do you think about them? Do you agree? Do you disagree? And what were some of the books you read in February? Did you love them? Did you hate them? Was it a good reading month? I hope it was. And if not, I hope you have some great reading time in March. As always, if you liked this video, please hit the like button down below. If you would like to see more of my videos, please hit subscribe, and thank you for watching.